My name's Stephen Parker. I'm the Vice-Chancellor here at the University of Canberra, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to another of our public lectures in a series that we call the Breakthrough Series. And tonight's lecture is by our colleague, Felicity Packard, whom I'll introduce shortly. Before I go further, I'd like to acknowledge, as we try always to do at public occasions at the university, that the land we are meeting on is land of which the Ngunnawal people are the traditional custodians, and I extend my respect to their elders, past and present. We developed this breakthrough series of public lectures as one means by which the University of Canberra can engage intellectually with our communities and bring out the many voices that a civilized community should hear from and think about. And I'm delighted that this evening's lecture stems from creative writing. The university has a growing teaching and research agenda in creative writing, with the establishment of the Center for Creative and Cultural Research in the Faculty of Arts and Design in March this year, led by Professor Jen Webb. But there are other examples of our commitment. We now have the UC book. So every year, a book is chosen through a competitive process. All first-year students and all members of staff receive a copy of the book, and it's intended to be a talking point throughout the year. We host the Lou Rees Archives of Children's Literature, and recently in this room, we had a public event where two of our graduates, Garth Nix and Maurice Gleitzman, talked about their work. And fairly shortly, I'll be announcing the establishment of a prize in a creative writing field, which I hope will be significant and have impact. Members of the Centre for Creative and Cultural Research are creative practitioners who produce not only traditional scholarly outputs, but also creative publications and performances, exhibitions, and professional inputs to cultural and community institutions. And Felicity Packard is one such practitioner. She is an academic, a screenwriter, a producer, and script editor. She's one of the writers behind the acclaimed Underbelly series. She was also associate producer for three series of Underbelly: Razor, Badness, and Squizzy Taylor. Other programs she's written for include MDA, Blue Healers, GP, Home and Away, McLeod's Daughters, Sea Patrol, and The Strip. This evening's lecture is titled Over There But Overlooked: The Creative Vision Behind ANZAC Girls. Felicity is currently the lead writer on a six-part drama series, ANZAC Girls, for the ABC, and for the past 18 months has been writing and co-producing the television drama based on the diaries, letters, and photographs of five World War I Australian Army Nursing Service nurses. ANZAC Girls is currently in post-production and is due to be screened to coincide with the centenary of the First World War next year. Felicity will discuss the creative vision behind ANZAC Girls and her desire to re-explore the powerful national narrative of ANZAC and the First World War. Please welcome Felicity Packard.
Thank you all very much. Thank you, Professor Parker, for the lovely introduction. Yes, so ANZAC Girls. I could seriously talk about ANZAC Girls for a long time, so you'll probably have to stop me. It's nice that there's just a few of you, so you can ask lots of questions at any time. I'm really not bothered by being interrupted. Okay, hope this all goes well. All right, so yes, as Professor Parker said, we're talking overlooked, and about ANZAC Girls, and about what inspired me in particular, but the whole production team and the writing team to make ANZAC Girls, to commit ourselves to writing ANZAC Girls. Okay, so what is ANZAC Girls? Again, ANZAC Girls is, as Professor Parker said, it's a six-hour miniseries. It's produced by a production company called Screen Time, who also did the Underbelly series, but we produce it for the ABC. That's how TV works in Australia. Independent producers produce for the networks. The series producer is a woman called Lisa Scott. There are four executive producers, two from the ABC, Carole Sklan and David Ogilvy. There are two executive producers from Screen Time, Des Monahan and Greg Hadrick. And then there's me, and I am the producer. There's lots of producers. If you watch the credits of anything, all those producers, they've all got something to do, something slightly different to do. So I'm the producer and the lead writer, And then there's another writer, Nikki Aiken, who I would like to point out is also a graduate of this institution. Nikki graduated from here a few years ago and has worked for Screen Time and has written for Underbelly and things like that. So I've written four of the six episodes and Nikki's written two. I'd also just like to briefly outline the production process, just so that you're across it, and so that even though I am going to talk more about the ideas behind ANZAC Girls, just so you understand how the process works. There's the lead up to the writing where I've done research and reading and all those sorts of things and written treatments. Then there we've had a 10-week pre-production period where you're doing the casting, you're getting your team together, you're finding locations, you're building sets, contracting directors, contracting enormous amounts of cast. We had a huge cast for ANZAC Girls. So that's 10 weeks of that. Then we've had a 10-week shoot, which was in South Australia, in and around Adelaide. 5 weeks for the first three episodes, which were directed by Ken Cameron of Brides of Christ and Fame. And there's a second block of a five-week block where we're doing the last three episodes, who have been directed by Ian Watson. And then we have 10 weeks of post, and we're in the post-production period now. We're 3 weeks into post, which is very exciting. And in post-production, you're layering in all the sound and the special effects and doing the titles and making sure the dialogue's nice and clear and all this sort of stuff. So that's what we've been doing so far. So I want to talk about where the idea came from, and it's not a simple process. Ideas don't arrive fully formed, they certainly don't for me. There's a long process by which you gradually gather stuff together. Basically, as I've worked with Screen Time and other production companies, we're very conscious of the fact that we're coming up to the centenary of World War I, and you want to do a project that taps into that world. And so we were looking around for a story that we thought would interest the networks. And what we particularly wanted to do, we were aware there would be other Gallipoli, particularly in Australia, other Gallipoli projects out there. And there are at least three other Gallipoli projects being developed at various stages of development at the moment. So we were looking, and so that's just outside of Australia. We were also aware that there will be other projects from around the world. The UK, I know, is the BBC's got hundreds of thousands of hours of programming, both documentary and drama, planned to celebrate the centenary of World War I. And of course, when 1916 rolls around, the Americans will start doing all of their stuff as well. So there will be a lot of material being produced in both documentary and fiction and drama, ours isn't fiction, to celebrate World War I. So we were looking for point of difference. We were really looking for something that would stand out from that pack, and which was also partly where the idea for ANZAC Girls comes in. So there we were looking around for something to take to one of the networks to celebrate World War I, and I found this book, which I would have put an image on, except I couldn't figure out how to do that. So, but it's called The Other ANZACs. It's by a Canberra author called Peter Rees, published by Allen and Unwin. And it's an account of World War I nurses who worked for the Australian and New Zealand Army Nursing Services. It's based on real people. It's based on real events. It's not, it's more or less chronological, but Peter chooses about... Oh, he'd look at least sort of 20 nurses of the 1,000 of the 3,000 who served. We've narrowed that down to five. So, but he looks at their diaries, at their letters. There's photographs, and he tells the story of the war, of the whole of the war, through their eyes. He says what was happening for them here, what was happening for them there, and he might tell us like the story of the first ANZAC Day service by looking at what was happening for the women who were still in Egypt and others, and then for those who were already in France and all that sort of stuff. So he builds up a picture of nursing experiences and of the progress of World War I through the eyes of a number of nurses. And so I was really, really attracted to that. The next issue... I forgot to put that one up. So the women, I was attracted to the idea that they were women rather than soldiers. That was a point of difference. They were real people rather than a fictional story. I was really attracted to that idea that we could tell the stories of real people. And coming off the back of Underbelly, I've had a lot of experience working with real people or the stories of real people and adapting them for drama.
The other thing that was very attractive about the other ANZACs and the stories it told us, it's practically unknown. Yet there are actually a number of books out there that deal with histories of the Australian and New Zealand Army nursing services, and some of them, they're terrific, but they tend to be scholarly rather than popular. Peter's is quite it's a popular read, and they're not very well known, except in particular circles. So I was really attracted to that. There's that point of difference. And as I said, Peter's book captures a sense of the people as well as the events. I was really, I'm a storyteller. I want characters who fall in love and have, fights and all that sort of stuff. I didn't want it to be, whatever I was doing, just to be a series of dates. It had to be more than that. And it's my underbelly experiences attracted me to this story as well. But then there's a whole lot of personal, that was the sort of professional stuff. But there was a lot of personal reasons why telling the story of Kiwi and Australian nurses appealed to me. I have Kiwi heritage. I was the only one of my family born in Australia. All my brothers and my parents are New Zealanders, and all my relatives, except for my immediate family, still live in New Zealand. So I've spent my whole life with an awareness that when we say the word ANZAC or the acronym ANZAC, New Zealand is embodied in that. And yet Australia doesn't really anymore acknowledge the New Zealand element, any more than New Zealand particularly acknowledges the Australian element. We both celebrate ANZAC Day, but you wouldn't know that either country kind of participated, except for the first line of the speeches, on that day, Australian and New Zealand forces, and then you sort of forget about the other country. So I've always been conscious of wanting to underscore the fact that we did it together. That ANZAC, if it means anything, it can only mean something for both countries and it has to be celebrated by both countries equally. So as that. I was very attracted to the idea of ANZAC nurses because I'm a woman. And I'm an Australian. I'm a proud Australian. I've gone to ANZAC Day services. I've sung at school. You can't avoid ANZAC Day if you've grown up in Australia or New Zealand. And I've always looked to ANZAC and I'm not there. There is no room for women in the ANZAC legend. It is an exclusively male story. And that's because only men got off the ships. That's fine. But I think we're old enough and mature enough as a country now to surely look at that legend and see what else it might say and where women might feature in that. I also have nursing connections. Three of my four sisters-in-law are nurses. My own daughter is about to graduate from midwifery at this institution. So I'm very pro-nurse. And nurses, like women in general, tended to be overlooked. Their work has tended to be undervalued. Not always. I'm speaking in generalisations. But there is an element of that. So I've always been keen to look at the story that valorises nursing. I have some medical connections to the First World War. My New Zealand grandfather was a doctor in the New Zealand Army who served in the Middle East in the First World War. And my aunt, who is another New Zealander, served with the Australian Army Nursing Service, as did lots of Kiwis in the First World War. So there's always been this sense that the First World War matters in my family. And my mother's cousin was killed at Gallipoli. So Gallipoli has always been part of the stories that we've told ourselves in the Packard family. Anyway. For all those reasons, the other ANZACs really, really appealed. So Screen Time acquired the rights to it and Peter's consultation rights as well, which is fantastic. And so began the long process of further research and also and this is where the underbelly stuff comes in, of sifting through this mountain of material to decide what is the story you want to tell. Who are the characters are you going to focus on? Because you can't tell it all. That's another story. I won't go into that now. But that's how we came to the other ANZACs and how we came to the story of Australian New Zealand Army nurses, which we then took to the ABC and they were very keen and were very supportive. And though there's a long, slow process of commissioning with the ABC, they commissioned it and we've been on the go ever since, writing and researching. So I mentioned what I wanted to do was also rethink and open up the story of the ANZAC legend. It's very easy. I mean, I have a sense, I don't think it's getting too particularly political, that over the last decade, or 15 years or so, the stories of ANZAC and the ANZAC landing has been co-opted by a particularly kind of hegemonic masculinity and a very conservative vision of what it means to be Australian. And what it means, and how, and it's been less easy, I think, to celebrate ANZAC in broad ways over the last decade and a half. And there's been a particular focus on a particular sort of ANZAC legend. And so I wanted to see what the much valorised concepts that we attach to ANZAC might mean in a female context. These qualities that we associate with ANZAC, I mean there may be others, but these are the ones that I kind of reckon we most that spring to mind, and that's mateship and sacrifice and humour in the face of adversity and courage and loyalty, and of course our nation's and New Zealand's birthplace, because neither of us have been around that long before that. So I didn't come to ANZAC Girls thinking I'm going to do all of this. It's what I've discovered as I researched and wrote, and what I discovered I wanted to say as I went through the process. So when you apply a female lens to the ANZAC legend, if you actually just think about it really in a really simple way, you think mateship and sort of bronze dozzies pop into mind, and they're always men. They're exclusively men, because that's how the legend is interpreted. Sacrifice and all those things that I listed before, I discovered that I wanted to explore them through this female lens. So what did I discover? Well, in terms of mateship, just taking them one by one, the nurses' friendships and loving support for each other is just extraordinary. They, you know, they supported each other, because all of them served through the whole 4 and a bit years of the war. So they supported each other with intense and amazing friendships in the face of terrible situations, which they're not mateships in the way that we generally think of mateships. They don't involve beer and backslapping, but, you know, the gift of a hanky, the gift of touch, the gift of being there when somebody's weeping. This, I think the ANZAC Girls allowed me to reimagine the ways in which mateship might be experienced by people who of the other gender. Sacrifice. Now, our nurses sacrificed so much in the time they served, not only in the Middle East but on the Western Front as well. They sacrificed health and happiness and their futures. They sacrificed parental approval, because many of them joined up without their parents' approval, so they had to endure that. They sacrificed an enormous amount of comfort. Now, comfort doesn't seem very much when you set it up against being shot at by the enemy over cliffs. But I'm talking about the nurses who served on Lemnos, and this is a picture of Grace Wilson on Lemnos, on the Greek island, which is only 60 k's from Gallipoli. They endured probably conditions as bad as the men were enduring in the trenches. They got without the being shot at bit, which I know is an important bit, but nonetheless, they were suffering terribly through that period. Many of the nurses died. They died through dysentery. They died from typhoid. They died, like an enormous amount of the population, through the Spanish flu. But they also died. 12 New Zealand nurses were killed in a notorious torpedoing on the Marquette, when the Marquette was torpedoed by a German submarine off Salonika. They died afterwards. Several of them suicided because they came home suffering post-traumatic stress disorder. Some experienced alcoholism. So only 30% of World War I returned nurses married. So they sacrificed a lot. Like the men who came back. We all know those stories of your great granddad who never really spoke again, who would have terrible nightmares for his whole life, who carried what we now call post-traumatic stress disorder with him afterwards for the years after the war, and it goes on now with people coming back from Afghanistan. The return nurses suffered that too, but that doesn't get mentioned. You know, and sometimes it was referred to as, you know, they were just being hysterical. You know, female experience was never kind of treated in the same way as male experience, even for when they were returned. So there's that sort of sacrifice they were making. It's not sacrifice in the sense of being shot at. It's a different sort of sacrifice. And this is what I mean by wanting to open up that story and see if there's other ways to acknowledge that these words matter. The nurses have extraordinary humour. Like we all know the stories of, you know, the larrikin Aussie and the fun that they have, and the way that the black humour that they took, that they they evinced, which helped them get through. Look, I'd have to say that our nurses are pretty funny women. They're just terrific. We've got a couple of quotes where one of them says to a man who, you know, he asks for a glass of water. He's in hospital. She says, "Oh, well, I'll get you one, but you'll be wanting flowers on your grave next." You know, if that's not black humour in you, it's that sort of thing. And another one comes across to a man who's looking very miserable, and she says to him, "Look, I'll do my best for you, but only if you're going to look a bit more cheerful." You know, so they're having a good time. They have a sense of humour. They have a sense of the situation. They have a sense that the only way to get through these terrible circumstances and the way to help the men is with a sense of humour. There's another one, which is, I'll get onto the pay in a minute, but one of them says in her diary, went to line up to get paid, waited to get paid, did not get paid. They're very witty. They're tremendous women. So I think that they also, you know, invent this very kind of ANZAC quality of humour in the face of adversity. Now we get to courage. There are different sorts of courage. You know, facing down enemy fire absolutely takes courage. Going over the top, you know, takes extraordinary courage, and nothing I say is to diminish that experience and those efforts. But I hope that as a nation we are big enough and grown up enough that we can acknowledge there are different sorts of courage which also ought to be celebrated and honoured. The courage to keep going. The courage to turn up to shifts. You know, they were working 16-hour shifts. In the first rush of the Gallipoli wounded, they were working 30-hour shifts. And they kept going and they came back. And they had to keep cheerful. They had to keep cheerful. They had to keep cheerful for each other, for themselves and for their patients. They had the courage to minister to injured men and sit with dying men. Now, that takes an enormous amount of courage, which doesn't tend to get... There isn't a place for that. There hasn't been a place for that in our stories of Gallipoli and of ANZAC. And I hope that ANZAC Girls... That's another reason I was really attracted to ANZAC Girls and that I discovered in ANZAC Girls. The women, the five women we look at, and many others, they served, as I said, the entire war. Now, mostly they were not in mortal danger, though there are a few notable exceptions, and they didn't have to kill anyone. But again, to say that the only victims or heroes of war that are worth celebrating are the ones who are in actual battle is another way in which the ANZAC and World War I has been kind of limited in, or has been defined entirely by the male experience. And that's another reason why I wanted to tell the story of ANZAC Girls. And it brings us to loyalty. These women were extraordinarily loyal, both to their boys, to each other, do they call them their boys, to each other, to their matron, and to their independent national identities. Which brings me to the Australia-New Zealand thing. Oop, too far. Nope, that one. Oh, how far did I go? That one, that's, sorry. Okay, so ANZAC, you know, as we've heard that story many times, that it was the birthplace of Australia and the birthplace of New Zealand and that sort of stuff. And, you know, the cliche, dare I say, is that Australia and New Zealand were born as nations at the Gallipoli landing on April 25th, 1915. Now, what does that mean? It means that, you know, we think of Gallipoli as defining the place at which we started to see ourselves as separate from our colonial pasts and related to, but no longer beholden to, or defined by our relationship with Great Britain. There's nothing new in that. And the nurses certainly experience that. But they experience it slightly differently to the men. And they experience it in a very direct way, because a lot of the soldiers, of course, were serving with entirely Australian units or entirely New Zealand units, but the nurses were working alongside the Brits a lot of the time in the hospitals. They weren't working in discrete Australian or New Zealand hospitals. So they had a very first-hand experience of what it was to come as an Australian or a New Zealander and work with the British and see how what attitudes they evinced. So, I mean, I think it's summed up by the attitude. This is they felt the British evinced towards them by Alice Ross King, who says in her diary, this is actually on the Western Front, she says, "One would think we were England's enemies instead of belonging to her by the way we're being treated here." So they had and this is a theme that runs throughout all the nurses' diaries and their letters, is their sense of injustice at how they're being treated, their sense of frustration. But before that, their sense of real surprise
and a kind of astonishment that they're being treated as colonials, because they go across there thinking, they're going to love us, you know, we're just all good cousins together. And it was, that wasn't the experience that they had. Now, not, of course, they had some lovely experiences with the with English staff and English, and lots with lovely experiences with English soldiers that they were caring for. But they had enough of the of these negative experiences, enough experiences which underscored that Australia and New Zealand certainly were not on par with Britain, at least in Britain's eyes, that they it made them reflect and take stock. And you can see that in their diaries. I mean, little incidences, that there was a huge fuss about the fact that the Australian and New Zealand nurses wore the scarlet cape. This, you know, the classic little scarlet cape, because in Britain, only the Queen Alexandra's Imperial Military Nursing Service, who are members of the regular army, were allowed to wear the scarlet cape, and nobody else was allowed to wear the scarlet cape. And in come these Aussies and Kiwis and their scarlet capes, and they get frowned at, and there's all sorts of outrage about this. So that, I mean, it's trivial, but it also kind of mattered in terms of identity, because I think the thing that struck me was two things. One, that this... the sense that they, all these nurses who come from quite a range of backgrounds, all write about this experience, this sense of dislocation that they experience with the British, and also their sense of surprise at it. They really didn't think it was going to be like that. They really didn't. The other thing that the nurses give us very quickly and very directly, because we can examine their diaries, is the sense of their sense of the gap between what's happening at the Dardanelles and the letters they're getting from home. And they're not alone in this. I mean, the soldiers experience this too. But because the nurses are getting more regular mail in those early days, we can get it quite, we get it really clearly. So you get lines, direct lines in diaries and letters, where one nurse says, what really gets my goat is the British going on that it's a simple thing, this forcing of the Dardanelles. If we tell the truth about this, we'll be called un-British. So their stories allow us to kind of explore that dilemma. Right, next. Another issue that comes up in ANZAC Girls, and another reason why I think it's a story worth exploring, it's worth looking at the World War One through nurses' eyes, is... how the army, the Australian army, in particular, treated the nurses. They were not treated particularly well. And yet the army comes out of Gallipoli really rather shiny in the public mind, at least as a first port of call. Oh, yes, you know, we just think of the army in terms of the bronzed Aussie, you know, soldier and the larrikin. And we don't actually kind of... Yeah, obviously people who know their detail understand the layers of the hierarchy. But in general, the Australian New Zealand Army, they were terrific. Well, I'd like to just draw pause and say they weren't always terrific. They certainly were not terrific to nurses. We might criticise the Brits about our... But our army has sort of been beyond reproach. And it might be true to some extent, but it's not entirely true. The nurses' experiences show that the Australian Army could be as hidebound and as stuffy and as chauvinistic and, yes, as misogynistic as anyone from Britain. Yeah, they were dreadful to the women in lots of ways. The army didn't treat, didn't, I mean, some of these issues, they were incredibly hostile towards, lots of the senior army were quite hostile to the idea of nurses being there. So there was a disconnection within the army anyway about whether nurses should be entitled to be there, how close they could come to the front line, all those sorts of things. And that hostility was expressed extremely directly. You know, we don't want you here. Well, we're here. You know. So there's that sort of elements. It also expressed itself in the fact that the orderlies, who were privates and subordinate in rank to the nurses, often wouldn't take orders from them. Even though back home in Australia, the wardsmen would have taken orders from the nurses when it came to the army, because then, I suppose for the orderlies, they were caught between two worlds. They didn't quite know who they should take orders from, but they certainly weren't taking them from the nurses. Nurses had honorary rank. They took a couple of months to sort out, but basically nurses had honorary rank. So a matron was a captain, a sister, like a fully qualified nurse, was a first lieutenant, and a staff nurse was a second lieutenant. So they were officers. They weren't enlisted
men, so to speak. They had rank, and so they clearly outranked the orderlies and many of the men whom they were treating. But that was very rarely recognised, certainly for the Gallipoli campaign. It was really difficult to have that recognised. So it made running hospitals very hard. Poor old Grace Wilson on Lemnos had to contend not only with, I mean, just dreadful climatic conditions and huge influx of wounded and remarkable hostility from her colonel, but the orderlies then not taking orders. And so people are dying because there's a miscommunication. So there's that sort of stuff. The other ways, the small ways, it would seem trivial but matter enormously, was that the army did not treat and respect these nurses in the way that they deserved, was they got paid less than half what an untrained orderly got. To be a member of the Australian or New Zealand Army Nursing Service, you had to be a qualified nurse. You had to have done 3 years of training, which is more or less what a nurse does now. They were qualified professional people, and yet they got paid less than half what an untrained orderly, this bloke, who signs up and says, yeah, I don't especially want to shoot, but I'm too old to go to the front line or whatever, for whatever reasons a man became an orderly, and yet they got paid less than half. They also had to provide their own uniforms and then got in trouble if their uniforms weren't uniform enough. Whereas the army provided obviously uniforms for the men. Now that's partly because the army wasn't used to having a nursing service. There's reasons for that, but then there was no allowances made. There was no sense of welcoming them with open arms. And final insult was many of them, once the war finished, they then had to work their passage back to Australia and didn't get paid. So there's these things which kind of seem shocking to us. They deal with remarkable good grace and aplomb, but it's other reasons why I think the legend of ANZAC never tells that sort of story. And I think it's worth telling it because it really happened, and it happened to real Australians and New Zealanders. The other reason why I've always been attracted to telling a story about the First World War, and why ANZAC Girls worked really well for that, is that ANZAC, the other ANZACs, and then our story, our show, the other ANZAC Girls, doesn't just talk about Gallipoli. Gallipoli so dominates the stories in Australia and New Zealand about the First World War, you'd forget that there were actually another 3 and a bit years of war past it. The Gallipoli campaign was 8 months. We spent 3 more years on the Western Front. And it's a really, really important... I think it's very hard... I'm not diminishing what Gallipoli means to Australia and New Zealand in terms of national identity, but I don't think you can really understand how Gallipoli sits in that story if you don't also expand the story, expand your focus to look at what happened on the Western Front. So that there far more Australians and New Zealanders died on the Western Front than died at Gallipoli. I mean, a lot of people died at Gallipoli. I'm not diminishing any of that. But the battle at Fromelles makes Gallipoli look like a resounding success. Fromelles was such a disaster, and the impact of that on the Australian Army and on the nurses who were then caring for this, well, most of them were dead, so they didn't have a lot to care for, but it was such a disaster. But that story doesn't really get told. I mean, people kind of know about Fromelles, and I know there are some here who are very keen on Fromelles, and that's great, but I think it's worth telling... worth acknowledging that the First World War, if it means anything, the whole of it has to mean something. It didn't just finish on the 19th of December when they withdrew from Gallipoli. We went on and we contributed and a lot of New Zealanders died on the Western Front as well, and we learnt from what we'd experienced at Gallipoli. Little things like, the way that the hierarchy, the way that orders went through changed, the way that the hospitals were arranged changed because of what happened at Gallipoli. So Gallipoli is part of the story, but it's not the whole story. Oh, that's very small. Oh, that hasn't worked quite as meant to. Okay, the other thing I wanted to do, this is now changing direction altogether. This is a song called The Rose of No Man's Land, which I will read out. I've seen some beautiful flowers grown in life's garden fair. I've spent some wonderful hours lost in their fragrance rare, but I have found another, wondrous beyond compare. There's a rose that grows on no man's land, and it's wonderful to see. Though it's sprayed with tears, it will live for years in my garden of memory. It's the one red rose the soldier knows. It's the work of the master's hand. Mid the war's great curse stands the Red Cross nurse. She's the rose of no man's land. Now, it's a lovely song. It's a lovely song. But there are elements in that make my skin crawl, particularly when you sit with the lived experiences of nurses, as I had the opportunity to do in writing this. Women's work over history has tended to be overlooked or to be trivialised or patronised, and this is, again, where my sense of wanting to tell a story about nurses rather than doctors comes in. And I think, and nursing in World War I tends to be overlooked or ignored or patronised, and I think this, for all that it's very sincere, is an intensely patronising piece of work. It's the ministering angels. You actually notice that she's this nurse of No Man's Land, the Rose of No Man's Land. She's actually the work of the Master's hand, so she's created by God. She's an angel. And now, you know, that's... I really want to resist that imagery. I think if it's true, it's only the tiniest portion of the whole lived experiences of World War I nurses. And I just... There's elements in it that mean that nurses are reduced to angels. I know that sounds funny to be reduced to an angel, but it actually stops them being... It means you don't have to pay an angel. She's doing it because she just comes from God and she's just feeling so good about life and just what does it out of a holy kind of calling. You know, you don't have to pay them. You don't have to provide them with uniforms. You don't have to provide them with... You don't have to look after them when they come back. It just undercuts them as fully-fledged human beings. Now, these next images are not very good because I'm not very good at this, but we get images like this. This is our Rose of No Man's Land. That's actually off the cover of the sheet music. And this. Oh, she's lovely, she's beautiful, but you'll notice she has no blood on her uniform. And her hair is very neat and long, and nurses never wore their hair out. They always wore it back. You know, it's that sort of stuff. And this one, which I discovered, is actually a very popular tattoo. The Rose of No Man's Land is a very popular tattoo, which is kind of weird. But anyway, you know, again, it's this angelic thing. She's almost got wings, you know. I want to show you what nurses really did. They did stuff like this. You know, this is a nurse in an operating theatre on the Western Front. You know, she's there, she's working, she's concentrating, she's professional, she's trained. And this one. This is in an Armstrong hut, again, on the Western Front. And it's, you know, we've got two nurses. They're probably two nurses for a ward of 30, you know, and they're working 16-hour shifts. This is what they did. They weren't ministering angels. They were hard-working, dedicated professionals. One more. There they are. Hard-working, dedicated professionals. There's them. They're just gorgeous. So I was very keen to kind of, you know, resist that the Rose of No Man's Land and find a way to acknowledge these women as real people who worked hard. They thought of themselves as professionals. There's the Florence Nightingale Pledge, which obviously predates World War I, and they, even in back in that, nursing is talked of as a profession, not a calling. Now, there's a lot about dedication and there's a lot about, you know, those sorts of qualities, but it's called a profession. And I just think that the stories, when other stories of World War I are done and nurses are included, they tend to be of the ministering angel kind. They tend to be of the Rose of No Man's Land kind. And, you know, maybe it's the underbelly writer in me, but I wanted to show these people as full-bodied, full-blooded, you know, real live human beings who suffered and worked hard and all those sorts of things. The other thing, the other reason why, if you call by buying into the Rose of No Man's Land imagery of nursing, it means that nursing is again reduced to a footnote. It's like, oh, and there were these angels, and they came in and they, you know, soothed my brow, and they did a lot more than soothing brows. You know, it's again placing women's work and nursing work and World War I nurses in this rather kind of leftover, kind of afterthought way. I really, really wanted, I discovered I really wanted to honour the women of the Army Nursing Services of World War I. And we only look at five of them, though there are others, obviously, in the background. But you know, I hope that in our story, you know, even though that we only look at five, we are honouring them all. New Zealand opened a chapel, the Nurses' Chapel, in Christchurch in 1927, and that was particularly to honour the nurses who died in the torpedoing of the Marquette, which I mentioned earlier. And that's fantastic. So since 1927, New Zealand has had a public space that you can go to honour Army nursing, the service nurses. Though I do have to say that the nurses' chapel was paid for by public subscription and donation, not by the New Zealand government. So let's not get ahead of ourselves there. But at least there was a public space. Australia had no dedicated memorial to service nurses until 1999, when we got the glassy thing on Anzac Parade. So it's taken a long time. So Anzac Girls is just part of an overdue honouring of these women. Another reason why I really wanted to tell the stories of Anzac Girls. So this is the stats, and they're vague, and you'll get slightly different statistics depending on which historian you look at, because they didn't keep very good records, I mean, in general, but particularly of nurses. So these numbers, you know, some will say three, you know, they slip around by a few numbers here and there. But basically, nearly, you know, 3,000 nurses from Australia and New Zealand served in the World War One, and a lot of them didn't only serve with the Australian New Zealand Army Nursing Services. That they served with the British, they served with the Red Cross, they served with the Canadians. They served where they could, and a lot of them are paying for their own passage to get across there. They are so keen to do their bit. Whereas the army pays obviously for the men to go across there, these women were paying for themselves to get across there. 210 were awarded the Associate Red Cross, which is a particular medal, an award given for medical staff. And so that's like the secondary tier of it. And 56, including Grace Wilson and Alice Ross King, two of our nurses, were awarded the Royal Red Cross. And then only seven Anzac nurses were awarded the Military Medal. Now, I want to talk about the Military Medal. The Military Medal was created by the King in 1915 when they realised that they wanted an award to recognise gallantry and devotion to duty under fire by other ranks, which means not officers, basically. They realised that there were these soldiers, these privates and NCOs who were, you know, behaving with extraordinary courage and gallantry under fire, and they wanted to recognise that, and good on them. So the King created the Military Medal. But it was created for other ranks. And nurses were not other ranks. Nurses were officers. Yet nonetheless, when these seven women did these extraordinary, extraordinary acts of bravery, literally under fire, they were acknowledged. They were not acknowledged as officers. They were still acknowledged. They were still kind of belittled. There's nothing belittling about an other rank getting a military medal when it's given to other ranks. But if you are actually an officer and you're given a medal which doesn't actually relate to you, I just think there's something slightly off in that. That's an aside. Ultimately, I'm really, really glad that at least seven nurses were recognised for gallantry and devotion to duty under fire. Well, there you go. Maybe. That's and didn't get one. Yeah. Well, then maybe then that's true, and I should be grateful. But I kind of don't want to be grateful. I want them to get what they deserved. No, but no, you're quite right. It gives us. That is an aside. I mean, my hesitation about the military medal is an aside. Ultimately, what Alice Ross King did on the night when she earned her military medal is extraordinary. I couldn't have done it. It's just amazing. You know, the risk she put, the personal risk she put herself at, and her devotion to duty. It deserves to be celebrated, and I'm very glad that it was able to be celebrated as this. So, what does this all mean in practical terms, in terms of what ends up on the screen? How did I try to write Anzac Girls to reflect all these influences and all these politics and all this gender politics and my desire to... How does that actually impact? It means that the female point of view dominates. It means, in practical terms, there isn't a scene without a nurse in it. We don't have what we call, in the trade, point of view, unless there's a nurse in that scene. There's one exception, but one tiny little exception, which they snuck through on me. But apart from that, we only have point of view with a nurse. It means we never go to the front line. If the nurses didn't go to the front line, we don't go to the front line. We didn't, this is back to this where I started on the point of difference. We didn't ever want to write a story about nurses where we thought, gee, what's going on over them there hills? If only we could point the camera that way. We didn't want to do that. We didn't ever want to give audiences a sense that more interesting stuff was going on up the Turkish cliffs or over the, you know, the Somme Valley. We want, so our story is squarely told through the nurse's eyes. It also means that there is, which means their personal lives are a source of drama. And that, again, it's not only that we wanted, it's a TV show and the ABC wanted it to be a big success, and that's wonderful, don't we all? That's one reason why you tell personal lives and tell the stories of romance. But also, it comes back, it's more fundamental than that. I think war stories shouldn't only be about guns and battles, that war stories involve human beings, and human beings fall in love, and human beings get ill, and human beings suffer, and human beings betray each other, and all these sorts of things. So this, it's not only that we wanted a successful TV series to justify putting in romances. I think they're part of the story. They are really part of the story, and they're part of the story of what Australians and New Zealanders lived through in World War I. So there's that. So there's this balance of professional and war and personal stories. We never leave the war. We never leave nursing alone for very long. We never leave the war alone for very long. We never leave personal lives alone for very long. It's a balance of all of them. And it reflects the reality of what they were going through. I mean, Alice in her diary will say one minute in the early days in Egypt, she'll say, I bought a new pair of pink slippers. We had 800 Tommies admitted from ANZAC. You know, and so, and then she'll talk about that. So, but their own lived experiences were a mixture. Now, that changes as you move through time. As they get into those long, hard years on the Western Front, you see them, their suffering come through. You see that lightness of touch deteriorate, as it did for the men in the trenches as well. But it's part of the story, their personal lives. It meant that in choosing from this wide mass of material, and who among all these nurses that Peter Rees talks about we were going to focus on, it meant choosing storylines and people that gave us this range of nursing experiences and female experiences and romances and family experiences. So we chose our people for those reasons. It also, I think, the other thing that happens on screen is we tell stories of... World War I was part of the... it allowed a great forward step in female emancipation because women had to take on men's roles and, we know, those sorts of stories. And what happened for the nurses is part of that. We see them take on roles in medicine that men had been completely dominated by men, so that the New Zealand nurses, our New Zealand nurse, trains as an anaesthetist and delivers anaesthetics, which is a role entirely occupied by men up until that point. We see them have to, obviously they have to give orders to people and have their orders respected and acted upon. The war, telling the story of war nurses allows us to understand how gender roles were changed and developed. And I think that's exciting too. We see that on screen. A bit more politics here. I see ANZAC Girls as a timely reminder. Young women today, you'd think that feminism has done its dash, that it's completely redundant, that we don't need it anymore, and that the rights that women enjoy in Australia and New Zealand are here and given and forever. I hope ANZAC Girls reminds them that less than 100 years ago, qualified professional women had to quit their jobs if they got married. You weren't allowed to be married and be a nurse. If they fell in love and got married, they had to leave their jobs. This is qualified professional women were paid at less than half the rate of far less qualified men. This is not that long ago. They had to have a chaperone when they went out, even though they were over 21. They could be dismissed for just having a man in the corridor of their room. There's this whole kind of moral imperative around all of their behaviours, which is, people can't explain that. You can't understand that today, but it's not very long since this happened. They were not treated as the officers they were, and they had their orders ignored because of their sex. And I think if ANZAC Girls reminds one young woman today that we should not take anything for granted, then I will be very pleased. Finally, here's our ANZAC Girls. And I'll introduce them in a minute. In making ANZAC Girls,
I'd say this again, in no way do I or my fellow producers or the ABC or Screen Time seek to diminish or downplay the efforts of the men who served in World War I, Australian, New Zealand, English, anyone. Writing and producing ANZAC Girls has only made me prouder to be an Australian, or should I say Antipodean, but it's also made me extremely proud to be a woman. And it's made me so proud of these brave women of ANZAC who did their bit with every bit as much courage and humour and sacrifice and tenacity as did the men who have had all the glory until now. It's not a level playing field. You know, hundreds of thousands of men served, only 3,000 women served. I'm not trying to say that they have to be accorded exactly the same status or exactly the same amount of space in the War Memorial or anything like that, but I do think it's worthwhile celebrating what they did, honouring what they did, and acknowledging what they did. The five nurses whose stories we tell, we have Grace, matron Grace Wilson in the middle, who's played by Caroline Craig. This is Grace on Lemnos. Big, one of the first pictures you see when you walk into the War Memorial is that picture. So we've got Grace Wilson. We've got down here, it's a bit hard to see on that one because it's sunny. This is Sister Alice Ross King, played by Georgia Flood. And Hilda Steele, who is our Kiwi nurse, because New Zealand was dithering, saying, will we send a nursing service or won't we? And it dithered so much that 12 New Zealand nurses just said, oh, bugger it, we'll join up with the Australians. And so they came. So Hilda was one of that. She's played by Antonia Preble. And then we've got up here Sister Elsie Cook, played by Laura Brent, and over here Sister Olive Haynes, played by Anna McGann. So Elsie and Olive and Grace and Hilda and Alice, they're every bit as much heroes and our national heroes and deserve to be celebrated as such. And that's why I think they've been overlooked, even though they were over there, and why I wrote ANZAC Girls. Thank you.
How strictly did you stick to the five women involved? Wouldn't it have been tempting to use a line from somebody else? So stick to the same personalities, the real people, but use someone else's line or an amalgam of some of their personal life or something like that to create a better story. What's the balance when you're writing that?
Look, it's always a balancing act. We have not given them lines, like because there's other well-known nurses, Australian Army Nursing Service nurses. Anne Donnell, the New South Wales Premier's Literary Prize has just been given to the woman who wrote a biography of Anne Donnell. Kitty, of Catherine McNaughton, Sister Kit McNaughton. And so she's a very well-known nurse. We've tended not to take any lines from well-known people because that's their lives. And we don't take incidents that happen. There was a wonderful story that we couldn't do about a nurse called Pearl Corkhill, who during a bombing raid on the Western Front, she went through and put basins on the heads of all the men in the tent and stayed with them. And another woman got a piece of shrapnel in her back and kept on working. You know, we didn't tell those stories because they didn't happen to our five nurses, even though they are really powerful stories. We chose these women because they had sufficiently powerful things happen to them. Having said that, we make compromises, as we did in Underbelly, as you do in any story based on real events. It's not a documentary. It's not a documentary, and nor do we pretend that it is. It's based on real people. Certain events, this is what the ABC disclaimer will say, certain events and characters have been changed or created for dramatic effect. So some things happen. We squash timelines. We spend three episodes in Gallipoli and then three episodes on the next 3 years on the Western Front. So the timeline in the Western Front gets kind of concertinaed. And so we're doing every battle. But you have those sorts of compromises. These five women, they all say, Grace actually sailed after the other four. So Grace was not there at the beginning of our story in reality, but she was there pretty soon afterwards. But we have them all sail together, because it makes for much better drama if they're all there together. It's a small, the historians and train spotters will say, she didn't sail until such and such a date or until in May. I can wear that quite happily, because we don't make her do, except for turning up early and spending a bit of time in Cairo, we don't make her do anything out of character or anything that she didn't do at other instances. So it's those sorts of compromises.
Sorry. Was there a feeling that...
I beg your pardon?
Was there a feeling from their stories that they knew what they were going into?
Absolutely not.
No.
No, no. No, all those clichés you hear about, home by Christmas and it'll be fun and, you know. The episode one is called The Girl's Own Adventure. They go, they sail off, they arrive in Cairo, in Egypt, in January 1915, and they think it'll be a doddle, you know. And they think, like the men did, that, you know, quick sneak, run up the Dardanelles, it'll be fine, no problem. You know, and they very quickly realise that, you know, the scales fall from their eyes. But no, they go over there with no idea. They think, though they have a, I think they think they're ready, and then they discover they were not ready, which is the army experiences too. The army thought, we are so ready, and they were so not ready. Or they were placed in a position which made it impossible to be ready. So I think what happens for the nurses in Cairo in the aftermath of the immediate aftermath of Gallipoli very much reflects what was happening for the men at Anzac Cove.
Felicity, I notice you made a specific reference to Fromel. Is that, I'm assuming, a particular importance in the story?
Yes.
As compared to, say, what was happening up the road on the Somme?
The Battle of Fromel assumes particular importance. Not that we don't go to the battle, but in terms of what happens for our characters, yes, it does. It features heavily.
And is that decision influenced at all by the fact that the whole Fromel thing has assumed a lot more, well, I won't say importance, but is much better known in the last couple of years?
No, that's a nice adjunct to our decision. No, it was influenced because of what happens, of the people they meet. Basically, you know, one of them meets a man at Gallipoli who goes on and serves at Fromel. It doesn't go well. Yeah, so Fromel, I was very excited that, gosh, look what's happened here. It reflects what we're now beginning to realise, how important Fromel was and how many people died there. The stats are extraordinary. Over 5,000 Australians died in a single night at Fromel, and only 8,000 died in the whole campaign at Gallipoli. Now, not diminishing any of those deaths, but it puts Fromel in perspective and why it's so important that any stories about World War I include the Western Front and hopefully include Fromel.
One of the interesting things about First World War is that there was a huge fundraising effort that was worked a lot by women in Australia. And one of the things that they did was raise a lot of money, particularly for the men on the front. Mm. And I haven't been able to find anything that was a fundraiser specifically for the women. That was for Red Cross and their activities, but there was no mention of the women.
No.
So did you find anything?
Didn't
like
find
that?
Anything. No, Red Cross parcels would come, though sometimes they came with useful things like 20 extra deck chairs. Or huge, the nurses complained because the Red Cross is obviously people have been beavering away in Bendigo making pillowcases. You know, and they're thinking, we're okay for pillowcases, you know, a few more other things would help. But no, the nurses, they tended, I mean, one of the other things that they didn't get was very good food, and they had to, whereas the men got plenty of food, the nurses for a lot of the time had to buy their own food and supplement it. So these parcels, food parcels, would come from the Red Cross for the men. Look, I have to say, the nurses never, well, not for a second, begrudged the men what they got, because, you know, they were lying there terribly injured or terribly ill or with trench foot or dysentery or any, so they never, you never get a sense of them complaining.